Happy Holy Week, everybody. Welcome to the Global Easter Prayer Gathering for pastors and church leaders. We're Rick and Kay Warren, and 40 years ago this week, Kay and I founded Saddleback Church here in Southern California. Our very first public service was on Easter Sunday, 1980. So this Easter is our 40th birthday as a church family. But about 30 years ago, I began an annual Easter prayer breakfast for pastors, just to get us all together to pray with each other and for each other as we began the most important week of our year. Now, at first, it was just a gathering of pastors in my city. Then we expanded it to pastors all over Orange County. And that grew, and we expanded it to all of Southern California, which is about 20 million people in five counties. And then this year, 2020, we expanded it to all 58 counties in California. But then the pandemic hit. And I began to get texts and emails and calls from discouraged pastors all around the world where public Easter services were being canceled due to the COVID-19 virus. So I knew that this year we needed to go global, and we needed to invite pastors from all around the world to come together for encouragement at the beginning of Easter week and to pray with each other and for each other. So thank you for joining us. Now, each year we come together as pastors from every stream of Christianity, not to talk about our distinctives, but to celebrate our one love for our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. There is no promotional or political agenda ever allowed. It's just prayer. It's prayer and worship together as we prepare our hearts to lead the Holy Week services. Now, of course, this Easter is like none we've ever experienced, not in our lifetime. In fact, this is the first time in 2,000 years of Christianity that churches all around the world will be unable to gather in large groups to celebrate Easter. But I'm here to tell you that while we aren't able to assemble, the resurrection of Jesus Christ will still be celebrated everywhere in hearts and homes. 2.3 billion believers, that's one out of every three people on this planet, will be honoring Jesus Christ this weekend. So we may be apart, but we're not alone. And we may be separated, but we're not isolated. And this may be bad weather, but we're still together. Easter is not a location, it's a celebration. And now, with technology, we're more connected than ever before. Now, because this is a global gathering of pastors and church leaders, I wanted to have a voice from each continent to lead us in prayer together. So I invited six other couples to help lead us. Okay, talk to us about the respected leaders that I've asked us to join us.
So first, leading us from North America, Rick asked Bishop T.D. Jakes to lead us in praying for all who are anxious and fearful in our congregations due to this pandemic.
Yeah.
And then leading us from South America, Pastor Carlito and Leila Paez, to pray for all the health workers who are risking their lives to save others.
Yeah.
They are true heroes. And then leading us from Asia, we've invited Pastor Tony and Mei Yao to lead us in praying for people and churches in financial hardship due to lost jobs and the economic impact of this pandemic. And then from Australia, we've asked Pastor Brian Houston to lead us in praying that our churches will be a light in these very dark days. And from Europe, we've invited Pastor Nikki and Pippa Gumbel to lead us in praying for each other as we prepare Easter messages to share the hope of Christ. From Africa, our good friend Archbishop Laurent to lead us in praying for spiritual revival to break out during these days. And then Rick and I will close in praying for all of you and all the churches that we will humbly depend on Christ during this pandemic and proclaim his grace in word and deed, not just during this Holy Week, but during the duration of this global pandemic.
Now, between some of our prayer times, we're going to be led in worship by some other friends we have, Tasha Cobbs, Chris Tomlin, Matt Redman, and Brooke Lagertwood. Now, our format is very, very simple and uncomplicated every year. First, the speaker will talk about a topic that we're going to pray about next. Then, we'll all have a moment of silence where you pray personally about this subject you just heard about. Now, sadly, we can't sit around tables like we always have in the past to pray with and for each other. Finally, our pastor or couple will pray for you and all of our pastors and church leaders. So thanks again for giving your time to be a part of this global Easter prayer gathering for pastors and church leaders. I know you're going to be blessed. So let's get started.
Pastors, I want to take this opportunity to say that if you ever thought you knew what you were doing, times like these are quite humbling. It's in these moments that you recognize, regardless to what school you matriculated from or what ranks or what camp or what doctrine or what theology, there are things being hurled at us now for which it is very difficult to snap out easy answers. And in just a moment, we're going to pray about those people in our parishioners, our congregations, our country, our world, that are fearful, who are followers on your websites and on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, and they are anxious and fearful. And I want to say to pastors, many of them say the right thing because they know what we want to hear. But beneath those positive confessions, there is dis-ease. We need to pray for them. I want to make the pastors aware of the fact that domestic violence is on the rise. In many, many cities, domestic violence is escalating because even though people say the right thing in public, at home they go home to fear and anxiety and worry, and they need something from us that calms them, that gives them peace, so that they don't take out their frustrations on those that are the most vulnerable. And I want to just take a moment and give us a moment of silence to soak that in, to receive that on the inside, to not assume that because people talk right or dress right or look right or say the right things that they are really okay. Let's do the deep dive examination to the hearts and the souls of men and ask God to give us the kinds of things that make a difference. And then we're going to pray together. Our Father and our God, as we stand here in the Potter's house this morning, the sanctuary virtually empty, it is only a reminder of the pandemic that we face not only here in America, but around the world. And those that view this video no doubt will not be watching from a sanctuary, though many of them are people who frequent sanctuaries. They are in homes, they are in isolation, some are in hospitals, some are in waiting rooms. Some are grieving. Some are concerned about loved ones in nursing homes. Some are just afraid. We know in your word, Lord, that you said you've not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. And yet we are so human that sometimes we are afraid. And yet we know in your word, you said, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, make your requests made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, we keep our hearts and minds, but sometimes we drop our guard and we're anxious. And so we come to you, Lord, admitting our own frailty and our own weakness. And we ask you, Lord, to strengthen those that are fearful, to comfort those that mourn, to speak to those that have anxiety right now, who are worried about the future, who somehow think that this pandemic has control. They fail to realize that you are still God and that you're still in control and that you have all power in your hand and that nothing that is current in our news is shocking in heaven. But you have a plan and you have a purpose and that you orchestrate all things after the counsel of your own will. And I pray right now that the peace that passes all understanding will keep their hearts and minds. I pray, Lord, for the kind of peace that you had on that storm-tossed sea when the boat was tossed to and fro and the waves were boisterous and everybody was afraid and you were asleep on the bottom of the boat. Let that kind of peace comfort them and strengthen them and aid them through this time of turbulence. I pray for anxiety to be worried about what might happen, what could happen, the possibility of something happening, the kind of anxiety that every time you sneeze or cough, you think I must have COVID-19, the kind of anxiety where the enemy constantly threatens you about you or your children or your loved ones that somehow you're going to suffer loss. I speak against it. I know that he is the father of lies. And I thank you, Lord, that your word is true. Now, Father, that closes prayer. You said, I am the Lord that healeth thee. And I trust you for healing being the children's bread. Healing not only from the pandemic that we all face, but healing from fear and healing from anxiety and healing from nervousness and nightmares and insomnia and all of the many manifestations of fear and anxiety. I come against it right now in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Lord, for healing us inwardly and outwardly, spiritually and emotionally, mentally, Lord, in every aspect of our lives. We eat the bread of healing and we receive the spirit of peace. Granted, Father, if you will, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
If you believe that the name of Jesus breaks every single chain off of your life, he's the chain breaker. Call his name Jesus. Yes, Lord. Let's go.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Yeah. There is power in the name of Jesus, yeah.
Here we go.
To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, yeah. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Let's do it together. There is power, say.
There is power.
Come on.
In the name of Jesus,
there is power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
There is power.
There is power.
It's in the name,
in
yeah.
the name of Jesus.
To break every chain.
To break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain,
yeah.
To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
And I love this one, just throw your hands up right here.
There's an army rising up.
And we won't keep silent, say there's an army.
There's an army.
Come on!
Break every chain.
Yeah.
Break every chain.
chain, chain off of my body.
Break.
Woo! One more time, raise it up. Say break.
Break
off of my mind.
Chain.
You got to.
Break.
You got one more time. Take authority and say break.
Break.
Chains.
Chain.
We command you to break. Break every chain.
To break every chain.
Yeah.
Break every chain.
Feliz Páscoa, irmãos e irmãs, ao redor de todo mundo, Igreja do Nosso Senhor.
Feliz Páscoa! Hoje nós celebramos a vida de Cristo que foi manifestada na ressurreição.
E isso excede toda e qualquer circunstância, qualquer coisa que podemos estar sentindo ou pensando. A grande verdade da fé cristã é que Jesus vive, reina e governa. Ele veio por nós, morreu por nós, ressuscitou por nós, vive, reina e governa. Esta é a grande mensagem da fé cristã. Esta é a nossa viva esperança.
Aleluia.
Celebramos a Páscoa, celebramos o Cristo, Cordeiro de Deus, que foi morto por nós. E como o apóstolo Paulo diz na sua carta, em 1 Coríntios, capítulo 15, versos 56 e 57, ele diz: onde está, ó morte, a sua vitória? Onde está, ó morte, o seu aguilhão? Mas graças a Deus que nos dá a vitória por nosso Senhor Jesus Cristo.
Aleluia!
Essa é a nossa vitória. E agora, vamos nos unir em oração, especificamente, por aqueles que estão na linha de frente, irmãos e irmãs nossos, que estão dizendo sim ao chamado para ir atender aqueles que mais precisam. Vamos orar pelos auxiliares de enfermagens, médicos, enfermeiros, profissionais de saúde, em especial nos países onde já temos uma situação mais acelerada de pandemia, na China, no Irã, na Itália, na Espanha, nos Estados Unidos, em especial no estado de Nova York, aqui no Brasil, em todo o mundo, irmãos que estão arriscando as suas vidas para cuidar de cada um de nós. Esse é um mandamento de Jesus. Jesus nos disse para cuidar dos doentes. E agora, como igreja, convido você a se unir à Igreja do Senhor Jesus, a orar pelos profissionais da área de saúde que estão na linha de frente.
Não há nada mais poderoso do que a intercessão. E essas pessoas estão colocando a sua vida em jogo em favor de todos nós. Todos devem receber o suporte em oração de toda a igreja. Todos eles, todos os profissionais de saúde precisam do nosso apoio, da nossa intercessão em nome de Jesus.
Então agora nós vamos dar um minuto para você orar, para você interceder por todos que estão na linha de frente e também os seus familiares que ficam em casa dando suporte e o apoio para que eles estejam lá fazendo aquilo que Jesus nos manda fazer. Vamos orar. Pai, exaltado, bendito e glorificado seja o Teu nome sobre toda a terra. Senhor nosso Deus, obrigado porque enviaste Teu único Filho, Jesus Cristo, que veio por nós, viveu por nós, morreu por nós, pagou na cruz do Calvário o preço, venceu a morte, ressuscitou, vivo está à direita do Pai e intercede por nós. Exaltado, bendito e glorificado seja o Teu nome. Papai, nos unimos com os nossos irmãos ao redor de toda a terra para clamar por aqueles que disseram sim ao chamado e foram para a linha de frente. Obrigado, Senhor, por cada auxiliar de enfermagem, por cada enfermeiro e enfermeira, cada médico, cada médica, cada um que está ali cuidando daqueles que mais precisam. Senhor, proteja a vida deles. Guarde o Senhor de infecções, mantenha-os saudáveis. Nós nos unimos a eles em oração. Também pedimos pelo emocional, pela vida espiritual deles. Fortaleça o Senhor no emocional e na fé, que eles mantenham firme a esperança em Jesus. Também nos unimos aos seus familiares, aqueles que enviaram os seus queridos para a linha de frente. Abençoe os pais que estão em casa orando pelos filhos, os cônjuges que estão orando pelos seus amados que foram para a linha de frente, os pais que enviaram os filhos ou os filhos aos pais, aqueles enfermeiros, médicos aposentados que saíram do conforto do seu lar para responder sim ao chamado. Senhor, proteja-os. Abençoe a tua igreja ao redor da terra que se une em oração. Tu és nosso grande El Shaddai, o grande, todo-poderoso Senhor. Tu és Jesus, médico dos médicos. Nós clamamos e aplicamos fé e cremos que o que está ligado na terra está ligado nos céus. Assim oramos no nome poderoso de Jesus. Sob o seu sangue clamamos e assim oramos em nome do Pai, do Filho e do Espírito Santo de Deus. Amém.
Amém. Amém. Amém. Amém. Assim diz a palavra de Deus. O Cordeiro que foi abatido é digno. Recebe o poder, a riqueza, a sabedoria, a força. Recebe a honra, a glória e a bênção. Amém.
Amém e amém. Ele vive. Feliz Páscoa.
On 27 March 2020, at a news conference, the International Monetary Fund director, Kristalina Georgieva, declared that the world's economy had entered a recession of a similar scale or worse than the 2009 recession. She commented, and I quote, "A key concern about our long-lasting impact of the sudden stop of the world economy is the risk of a wave of bankruptcies and layoffs that not only can undermine the recovery, but erode the fabric of our societies." As the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on the world's economy continues to deepen and worsen, it unnerves businesses and employees. There is a record-breaking spike in unemployment across the globe, resulting in many people losing their jobs or seeing their income significantly reduced. Churches are not spared. Tithes and offerings to support the ongoing operational and maintenance of churches have dropped drastically. Few churches have the blessings of a few months' operating expenses in their cash reserves. Plans for cost-saving measures are now in process. Pastors and church staff are anxious if there will be any staff layoff or cut in their salary. Donations to charity organizations have reduced significantly too. This is not the first time the world is encountering such a pandemic. The Church of Jesus Christ has stood the test of time as we reflect on the history of the church. In such a time as this, we need to remember to hold fast to the truth of God's word in the midst of this chaotic situation.
Zephaniah 3:17, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save." There are three encouragements that we can glean from this passage. Firstly, the Lord is God. God is sovereign in His purpose. Secondly, the Lord God is in our midst. He is with us. He is faithful in presence. Thirdly, the Lord is mighty to save. Nothing is impossible with God. He is mighty in power. The Chinese word for crisis is 危机, comes from two Chinese words, 危, which means danger, and 机, which means opportunity.
This crisis is not just a time of danger and adversity. It is a time of opportunity for the Church of Jesus Christ to turn to the Lord together in prayer. And we pray for more than just an end to the pandemic, but for God's name to be exalted in all the earth, for lives to be saved, for churches to be revived, for nations to be transformed, and for the world to be evangelized. This is a season of increased fears and anxieties, but it's also a season of increased openness to the gospel of love and hope. Right now, let us take 1 minute of silence to pray for everyone who has suffered financial losses and loss of jobs. Let us pray together. Let's close in prayer together. The psalmist declare in Psalms 121, I lift up my eyes to the hill. Where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. Oh, the Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Oh, Lord, we declare you are our God, whether in plenty or in need. Give us the grace to choose to praise you still. Even in the valley, you are faithful. We cannot see it now, and we can only trust that you're working for our good. Your word declares also in Psalms 31, verse 19, how great is your goodness stored up for those who fear you. There is no end to the loving kindness that comes from you each day. Oh, your mercies are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Oh Lord, we declare your truth over our lack and our losses right now. You are all that we need and all that we can cling to. You have never failed in your promises. Each of your promises are a yes and amen in Christ Jesus. You promise that you will supply all our needs according to your glorious riches in Christ Jesus. So Lord, we come to your throne of grace right now in our time of need. We look to you and ask that you open up your hands. In our lack, show yourself loving. And we pray for those who are able to be willing and ready to share with those who are in lack. Our times are also in your hands. Deliver us from every confusion and fear. Take us from fear to faith, even when we can't see how the future unfolds. You are there with us in our past. You are here right now in our present, and Lord, you will be there in our future. Our past can never be reversed, but we know they can and will be redeemed by you. Through this, demonstrate your goodness and your greatness once again. That through our lives, we have a God story to proclaim. You alone are God, our help in ages past, and our hope for years to come. And now may the abounding love of God, our Father, the amazing grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the abiding peace and presence and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us all from this time forth and forevermore. Amen.
Stories of what they think you're like, but I heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. I am.
God bless all of you, and God bless His church all around the world.
Well, big hello to all, and we're all filled with hope for this Easter and what God is going to do. I know, Brother Rick, you asked for Bobby to be with me, but she was unable to be here, but I want to talk, and I've been asked to encourage churches to be the light and to pray we can be the light during such incredibly stormy seasons. I love being a local church guy. I love leading a body of people and seeing them grow in the things of God and become all that God's called them to be. And I love challenging our church to step out there and actually be the light. When in Isaiah 60, the Bible says, "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you, and kings shall come to the brightness of your rising." And it goes on in that fashion. I love to take a hold of that and believe our light has come. This is our day. They are challenging days, no doubt about it, for the world. We've never seen anything quite like it. Who would have thought, even just a month ago, that at Easter, all of us would be being innovative and coming up with new ways to take the gospel out to thousands, between us all, millions of people. It's a great opportunity for us to truly be the light. I think we, with confidence and with faith in our heart, need to hold close to the message that we have and realize that people need, people want what we have. Already the Google searches for words like prayer and faith and hope have skyrocketed because people are hungry right now, and we have the chance to be the light. I was just reading in Isaiah 7, where the king of Judah, Ahaz, was under attack. Other armies were conspiring against him. Other kings were conspiring against him. And he naturally got fearful, started to feel afraid. But then the word of the Lord came to him. And the word of the Lord sounded like this: be careful, keep calm, don't be afraid, do not lose heart. Great, great words for us in this time. We're going to be the light. So we must be careful. We must keep calm. We refuse to be afraid, and we're not going to lose heart. But then it goes on in the NIV version, and this is what it says. It will not take place. It will not happen. Some of the things we may fear surrounding even the practicalities of bringing the message of Jesus to people this Easter. Why don't we take a hold of those prophetic words right there? It will not take place. It will not happen. God is not going to let you down. And then finally, the actual words in the scripture is, if you do not stand in your faith, you will not stand at all. If you do not stand firm in your faith. And you know, the Hebrew word for faith there is amen, or our amen. It's saying, if you do not stand firm in your amen, you will not stand firm at all. I know Jehoshaphat, when he was being attacked by a million people, he got a similar word. And the scripture started to talk about trust and belief, but it's the same root word. If you stand in your amen, you're going to see answers. Well, we're going to be the light, aren't we, pastors? We're going to see God do good things. We're going to report of reaching more people than we've ever reached before. We're going to ask God to make us so innovative that people are drawn, people are hungry. In the middle of it, let's not be fearful. Let's not be nervous. Let's remember that God is on our side, that when it looks like the enemy's going to try and attack us and rob us, it will not take place. It will not happen. If you don't stand firm in your faith, you will not stand firm at all. So thank God we can be people of faith. And I find that when we live with a message of hope, not just grumbling and complaining about the situation, but we've got such a chance to be giving people hope, put faith inside of people, encourage them to rise up and be all that God's called them to be. This Easter is a fantastic and exciting challenge because we're not just doing more of the same. And as we all together combine our forces, I'm going to pray that more people will be reached in this Easter 2020 than ever before in the history of the world. And we have the technology, we have the ability, we've got the prayer of our fellow saints, we've got all the people around us. So what are we going to do? We're going to be careful, like the word says. We are going to keep calm. We're not going to be afraid. We're not going to lose heart. We're going to start believing. It will not take place. It will not happen. We're going to stand firm in our faith. And as we stand in our faith, it means we can stand in the promise of God. Encourage you, Pastor, be bolder than ever before when it comes to the word that you preach. Have a greater confidence that God is with you than maybe you've ever felt before. Let's believe for the anointing of the Holy Spirit to be so evident, so present in our lives as we give out this Easter time, but we can't help but see response. People giving their lives to Jesus. I guess some people normally would baptized at Easter, baptize people in water. I don't know how possible that is or isn't right now. Different parts of the world, we all have different restrictions. But I do know that there's from this Easter time going to be a whole lot of people who will want to, in the future, leave their old nature behind in that water and come up identifying with Jesus. This is our time. This is our moment. This is our season. I believe that we're alive for such a time as this. I believe that God can take us to shine the light this Easter time, and my goodness, multitudes will come to the light, to the brightness of His rising. God bless you. Father, I pray for every pastor and leader around the world who's leading people this Easter time. And our trust is in You, and our hope is in Your name. And we know, Lord, You've gone before us and You come behind us, and we're on the winning side. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi. The gospel is the power of God for salvation, for everyone who believes. I discovered that myself. When, as an 18-year-old atheist, I encountered Jesus, I heard the gospel and my life was changed. For the last 46 years, I've had the privilege of proclaiming that good news and seeing the immense change in people's lives as they encounter Jesus and the power of the gospel. And we have the huge privilege this Easter of proclaiming that message afresh. And it's never been more relevant than at this moment. We're living at a time of huge crisis and tragedy as a result of the coronavirus. But the message of the gospel is that God took the greatest tragedy of all time, the cross, and turned it into the greatest triumph of all time through the resurrection. And this message of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus is a life-changing message that is more relevant than ever. And it's also more needed than ever.
Everybody's world has been completely rocked. The normal has gone. People are gripped with fear. Much of the world is in lockdown. People are feeling so isolated, alone, separated from their loved ones, all locked in small flats with all their family and not getting on very well. Whatever it is, the good news of Jesus is never more needed. People feel as though everything's been taken away from them, and they're looking like they were looking for Jesus when He was taken away from them. They're looking to Jesus to find Jesus. They need the good news of Jesus. Where is He? They're going to see Jesus at last, risen from the dead, but they're in that stage of being lost, lonely, and forsaken.
And I've never known a time in my life when people are more open than they are now. There are no other distractions. There's no football, there's no sport, there's no entertainment. And people have time to hear the gospel. And people who would never have gone to church, the church is coming to them in their homes. People who would never have explored faith are coming to explore faith online. This is the most extraordinary time to see this is not a moment to retreat. This is a time for the kingdom of God to advance. And you have been anointed by the Holy Spirit to proclaim this message. And I want to pray for you right now that the Holy Spirit will refill you, re-anoint you as you proclaim this message this Easter. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you because He's anointed you to preach good news. Lord, that's our prayer right now. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill each person who's watching this right now. I encourage you, if you'd like to, just maybe to open your hands as a way of saying, Lord, come and refill me, re-anoint me this Easter to proclaim the most powerful message in the world. Come, Holy Spirit. The Spirit of the Lord is resting on you because He has anointed you to preach good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for for the captives, to set the prisoners free, to open the eyes of the blind, to bring the oil of gladness instead of despair.
And we pray for every pastor as they prepare these messages at Easter, that you would give them wisdom, revelation, that you would empower them as they write these messages. Lord, would you strengthen them? Everyone who is weary, would you refresh them with your living water? Would you give them courage? Courage to proclaim the good news of Jesus. Courage again to remember that you have conquered the world and we're on the winning side because of the victory of the cross. And Lord, over everything, would you pour your peace, the peace that the world can't understand, where people are frightened and isolated. Lord, meet them, pour that peace in to every life.
And Lord, we pray that once again, you would turn tragedy into triumph, and that in all things you work together for good, that you would use this events, these horrible events that are happening, you turn them around for good, and that you would use it to bring the kingdom of God to advance as people encounter Jesus, are filled with the Holy Spirit, get excited about their faith, tell their friends that there would be a great harvest like we have never seen in our lifetime.
Hey everyone, hey Pastor Rick, it's a pleasure to worship and pray with you today. And just want to say, as pastors and leaders, so appreciate you right now, trying to navigate new ways to lead and love. So great we can gather together today.
Thank you. Lent greetings from Rwanda. I'm here to request you to pray for Africa. Pray for spiritual revival to break out during this time. We have an amazing opportunity. It may be a threat because of the pandemic, but it is an opportunity also that is given to us. We are in our homes, churches are closed, but the Bible and our fellowship with the Lord is not closed. So we have opportunity to pray that during this time that we are in our homes, that when we get opportunity to come out, when the pandemic is gone, we can come out with a strong spiritual relationship with our Lord, spiritual relationship and fellowship with God. How I pray that we will take this time to pray for each other and to pray for spiritual revival. Andrew Murray said, "A revived church is the only hope for a dying world." My brothers and sisters, I encourage you. I encourage you to pray for our personal relationship and fellowship with God. Many, as we have seen there, we are all aware of people out there, even church leaders, even pastors, who are away from the Lord, who have been challenged by the pressures of this world. We need to pray for ourselves. We need to pray for a fellowship with God. We need to pray for a revived relationship with God. We need to seek God for our own spiritual revival. We need to pray for our families and many families on this continent of Africa. There are many broken homes, and the devil knows where to attack. When he attacks our homes, our families, our children, may I encourage you to pray for our broken families around the continent. We need to pray for our local communities, our local churches, our nations, that the Lord will restore our spiritual vitality for the gospel, to proclaim the gospel unashamedly to the world. We need to pray, as we have seen and see, and it is so obvious today, there seems to be a low awareness of God, reflected by the way we live, reflected by the way we behave. We can see it all around us. The culture that we see that comes from the West and other places, we can see it invading our youth in Africa. Pray for a revival. Worldwide, we see a moral and spiritual decline. Africa is no exception. We encourage you to pray that the Lord will touch our hearts, our communities, our countries, starting with us. We need to pray for the pandemic of the coronavirus. We need to pray for the crisis that created by the locusts in some of the East African countries. My brothers and sisters, you are seeing many and more people who are turning away from scripture, being influenced by the current culture. Let us pray that the Spirit of God will touch the continent of Africa, will touch the people of Africa, will touch all of us. May I encourage you to take a minute from where you are, from where you stand, to pray that the Lord will touch us individually, that the Lord will touch our families, that the Lord will touch our churches, that the Lord will touch our communities. Let us pray. Psalm 51 verse 10. It says, "Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me." That was a prayer that David was praying. Let us make it ours today. Let us pray. O God, you have made one blood all the peoples of the earth, and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are afar off, to those who are near. Lord, grant that people everywhere may seek after your Spirit upon our flesh and hasten the coming of your kingdom. Ignite a revival in us. Make us alive for a spiritual fellowship with you and for the proclamation of the gospel unashamedly to Africa and to the rest of the world. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7 verse 14, it says, "If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and heal their land." Oh, how I pray that the Lord will use you to pray for a spiritual revival on this continent of Africa. Lord, we want to be revived. We want revival, oh Lord. We want to turn away from our sins and all worldly distractions. Father, give us a new spiritual hunger. Give us heartfelt repentance. Give us hearts that are hungry for your word and prayer. Give us a new concern for the lost, Lord, we pray. Almighty God, our Savior, you desire that none should perish. And you have taught us through your Son that there is a great joy in heaven over every sinner who repents. Grant that our hearts may ache for the lost and broken world. May your Holy Spirit work through our words, deeds, and prayers that the lost may be found and the dead made alive, and that all your redeemed may rejoice around your throne. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now, in our last prayer time together, I want us to pray that we will be totally dependent, humbly dependent on God during this pandemic, not just during Holy Week, but during this entire time when we're helping our people go through dark days. You know, to make it through a dark day, you've got to hold on to a promise. And to me, the great promise that is going to carry us through this time is Romans 8:28. "And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who are the called according to his purpose." Now, that's not a promise for everybody. It's only a promise for his church. For those who love God are called according to his purpose. Everything is not working together for good for those who don't love God. But the Bible says that for us, everything, including a pandemic, in everything, God works for good. It's not all good. The pandemic is not good. The deaths are not good. The illnesses are not good. The economic devastation is not good. There's a lot that's going on bad in the world right now. But as we depend on Christ, we know that even in bad times, God specializes in bringing good out of bad. That's the message of Easter. That's the message of resurrection. God loves to turn crucifixions into resurrections. Bad times for the world can be good times for the church because it's time for us to shine, to show our love, to show our grace, to show our compassion for the least, the last, the lost, the sick, the confused, everybody around. People are more open to the gospel now than at any other time. And so let's look at this time where we humbly come to God and say, God, we are depending on you. We're counting on you, not just to protect us, not just to save us, but to make us vessels of your love, instruments of your grace, ministers of your word and power in the world. And that's going to take humility. It's going to take dependence upon God. So what I want to do in this prayer time is in this moment, I want you to ask God to help you claim the promise of Romans 8:28, that even out of this terrible situation, God will bring good, and that God will use you, and it will bring good to your church in all of this time of crisis. I want us to wait now for a little moment and pray quietly, silently by ourselves. And then, Kay, I'm going to ask you to lead us in prayer when we come back.
As I was thinking of how we can pray in our most humble way for God's help, for his care for us, I was thinking of Psalm 91. And I wanted us to join together, as probably millions in the last few centuries, last thousands of years, have prayed this prayer in times of plague, in times of pestilence, in times of illness, of great, great darkness. And so we join our prayers in praying these words back to God. God, you have said that those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. And God, we declare to you today that you alone are our refuge. You are our place of safety. You are our God, and we are trusting you. You have said that you will rescue us from every trap, that you would protect us from the fatal plague. And we're asking you to shield us with your wings. We are asking you to shelter us with your feathers. God, your faithful promises are our armor and our protection. You've told us, God, that we don't need to be afraid of the terrors of the night, that we don't need to fear the dangers of the day, that we don't need to dread the plague that stalks in darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. God, you have said that though 1,000 fall at our side, and though 10,000 are dying around us, that these evils will not touch us. But we will see it with our eyes, and we will see how the wicked are punished. Lord, you have told us that if we would make you our refuge, if we would make you the Most High our shelter, that no evil would conquer us, and we pray that. God, we ask it, just as millions have asked it before us, that no plague would come near our dwelling. You order your angels to protect us wherever we go, and you've said that they would hold us with their hands and keep us from striking our foot on a stone. We don't even understand all of this, but we pray it back to you. You've said that we could trample down lions and poisonous snakes, and that we could crush fierce lions and serpents under our feet. And we pray, as millions have prayed before, that you would rescue those who love you, that you would protect those who trust in your name. And we are asking you, God, as we call on you today, that you will answer. You've said, I will be with you in trouble. And we ask that you be with us. This is definitely troubled times. You have said that you will rescue and honor. And we ask that you rescue and honor us. God, you have said that you would satisfy us with a long life and give us your salvation. And so we bring to you the words in your word, and ask for your protection, and tell you that we're trusting you, we're believing that you will shelter us, we're believing that you will protect, that your faithful promises are our armor. God, there are moments when we feel very frightened about the dangers that stalk in the day and in the night, and instead we turn to you and make you our refuge, our hiding place, and we believe that you will answer your word. In Jesus' name, I pray.
Amen. Now, before I give you a closing word, I want you to listen to this song.
wish we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Thank you again for joining us. I want to leave you with two verses specifically for pastors. Ephesians 3:10 tells us God's intent was that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known. God created the entire universe because he wanted a family. And the only thing that's going to last is the church. 1,000 years from today, if Jesus Christ hasn't come back yet, there won't be a Microsoft or an Apple or a Starbucks corporation. There probably won't be a United States of America in 1,000 years. Why? Because nothing man-made lasts forever. Where is the Hittite Empire, the Ugaritic Empire, the Sumerian Empire, the Akkadian Empire? They're all gone. But I want to tell you this. If Christ hasn't come back in 1,000 years, the one thing you can count on still being here is the church. It's the only thing that's going to last. Your ministry matters to God. And in this day where everything is changing because of this pandemic, economies are changing, alliances are changing, values are changing. The one thing that is unchangeable is that Christ, the Bible says, died for his church. It is his bride, it is his flock.